so much for bringing us together today for us to worship. It is always good to be in the house of the Lord. And we know that where two or three are gathered in the name of God, His presence is there. I can feel the presence of God in our midst. My prayer is that God will help us so that our worship will be acceptable in His sight. I understand that some of our church members have traveled, and so they are not here today. I know of Belinda, and I know that Paul's family is not feeling fine, so they are not here, and some other families that I cannot mention their names. Let's continue to pray for them, and that the Lord will be with them wherever they may find themselves. And I also understand that there are some people who have come to worship with us for the first time. I would like to seize this opportunity to welcome you to our church family. Once you enter this house, you are part of us. So we welcome all of you. I pray that you also benefit from our worship today. And let this not be the first and the last time you are visiting our church. Every Sabbath, our doors are opened. Please come and worship with God's family. Before I proceed, I would like to share some few points that arose from the board meeting we had last Tuesday. Last Tuesday, the church board met. And I would like to inform you that if you turn to the bulletin, turn to the back of the bulletin that you are holding, you will see that the church has a budget. And the budget, the amount that is needed every month is 7,100. And this amount doesn't meet the expenses of the church. So the board has decided that we are increasing this amount from the 7,100 to 8,100. We have added, or we're going to add 1,000 to this amount. It means that we have to give more than we have been giving. Because there are so many expenses that the church needs to incur. And we are supposed to be the ones, you know, paying for that. So please, let's do that. And another point that I want to bring to your notice is that the board also voted to begin church election process. We need to have our new officers in place before this year ends so that they can go through the conference training that begins every first week of the first month of every year. So please, we bring this to your attention. Next month, we will begin the process. But until that time, let's continue to pray that the Lord will lead the process and the Lord will touch hearts so that all will be willing to accept roles in the church. Let's continue to pray on that. Shall we pray? Almighty Father, we have come to your house today and we thank you that you are here with us. We thank you, dear Lord, that we can claim the promise that whenever we sin against you and we come and beg for forgiveness, you are ready to forgive us. Pardon us of all the wrongs we have committed against you. At this moment, I pray that you prepare the hearts that are here and may your words, dear Lord, go a long way to draw us closer to yourself. Thank you so much. Answer prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. So I'm going to use the next few minutes to share with the church short sermon that God has given me to share with you. And this sermon, I pray that it will help all of us to have a closer walk with the Lord. A short sermon with the title, Run with Endurance. Run with Endurance. And this morning, I want to take all of us to a stadium. I know that some of us have visited stadiums before. We've gone to stadiums, stadiums before. We've been to different stadiums. And we have been there to watch either soccer, football, athletics, volley, and different games. But the game that we are going to watch today is not soccer. It is not football. It is not volleyball. It is athletics. And it has to do with running. If you go to the stadium to watch race, some of them are short race and some of them are long race. And we are going to run now. I want to bring to our attention that all of us are in the stadium and we are all running. We don't have to go to any other stadium to watch athletes, to watch people run. We are running. Just as sometimes we go there to cheer people up. We are running, and who is cheering us up? God is cheering all of us up as we run. The text that was read to us, and I want us to take a very key interest in this text. You might not understand the text, but if you go home, take time to ponder over this text. It will speak to you because it has spoken to me. And the text reads from Hebrews chapter 12, 1. Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. Straight away, you should be aware that a race is set before us. How are we running this race? We need to run with endurance. And the good news is that some people are watching us as we run this race. We have witnesses. So this is the race that all of us are running. Let me share with you this interesting story about this man. You might have heard about him. If you have not heard about him, when you go home in the evening, you can Google and get more information about him. His name is Cliff Young, and he is an Australian potato farmer. Australian potato farmer. This guy, there was a time that the world was having a marathon competition in Australia. People from different countries went there to compete in this marathon. And when they were about to start the race, this man from nowhere came to the field, went to the organizers and told them, I want to be part of this competition. Aye, you have not registered. We don't recognize you. But he insisted, I want to be part of this race. The organizer said, we don't have time for you to go home and prepare and come. From the look of things, you have not prepared to compete. If you look at your dress, it doesn't show someone who is ready to run. But he said he was going to run. Look at the kind of boots, shoe that he's wearing. This shoe, the shoe over here, that is the one this guy was wearing. And if you have witnessed people who run, you know, you see them and you know that they are going to run because you see the way they have dressed, their shoes, everything indicates that they are ready to run. But this man was different. He went there from nowhere and said he wanted to run.
The organizers put their heads together and said, well, since this man is insistent, let's allow him to compete. But the audience, the spectators, were angry. They didn't want him to compete because he was not ready. He was 61 years, and this competition took place in Australia, as mentioned, in 1983. So it is a real story, something that really happened. So they allowed him to compete. They started, and it took them 5 days to finish with the competition. They had to run for 544 miles. He started, and people did not trust him. But the good news is that, surprisingly, he was the one who emerged the winner of the marathon competition. When he died, they had this monument for him, and they put this shoe there to indicate that he wore the wrong shoe, but then he emerged the winner of that competition. We are running. You might not look like qualified, but I want to encourage you that don't give up. Just start the race. If you have already started the race, don't give up. Move forward and run. Paul, in many of his writings, compared the Christian life to a race. In every race, there is a starting line. There is a finish line as well. And there is a prize. For this man, when he emerged the winner of the marathon competition, he received a prize. He started from somewhere, and he ended somewhere. But you know, one surprising thing about this guy was that those of us who like watching race, especially the 100 meters, the 200 meters, sometimes the one who emerges winner, the space between him and the second is sometimes very close. But this man, when he crossed the finishing line, it took the second person 9 good hours before he also crossed. It means he did very well. Very well. Okay. So we are running. And I said, Paul compares our Christian life to a race. We see in the book of Corinthians, Paul wrote, Corinthians, 1 Corinthians chapter 9, 24, he says, know ye not that they which run in a race run all, but one receiveth the prize. So run, that you may obtain it. We also go to Galatians. Paul wrote to them. I just want to lay emphasis to the fact that Paul compares our Christian life to race. He wrote to the Galatians by saying that, Galatians chapter 5, verse 7, you were running very well. Who hindered you from obeying the truth? You started very well. You know, I mentioned that in every race, there is a starting line. And there is a finish line. It is important to start, but it is more important to cross the finishing line. Because if you start and you don't cross the finishing line, it means there's no prize for you. You need to do that. We also see Paul writing to the Philippians. He wrote in Philippians chapter 3, 13 to 14 by saying, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark, that for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Paul wrote to the Philippians and told them, encouraged them, that there are so many things that can distract them. They don't have to look to their left, to the right, to the back. They always need to press forward. saved. And Paul was saying that that was his practice. I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Jesus Christ. When Paul was arrested and was to appear before Caesar in Italy, people were worried and some even tried to discourage him that, Paul, why are you worrying yourself? This is what Paul said to the people. Acts chapter 20, verse 24. However, I consider my life worth nothing to me. My only aim is to finish the race and complete the task the Lord Jesus has given me. We do so many things in the church, so many activities in the church, so many interesting programs in the church. What is your only aim for being a member of this church? What is your only aim for being a Christian? Paul says that my only aim for being a Christian is not to fall sick and people come to visit me. That is very good. When I get it that way, praise the Lord. But whether people visit me or they don't visit me, my aim is to finish the race and to complete the task the Lord Jesus has given me. The task of testifying to the good news of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Christian race is not like a 100-yard dash. It is more like a marathon. If you are running 100 meters, sometimes it takes a few seconds and you are there. But for this race, we know the starting point, but we don't know when we are going to finish. And we should continue to run this race. There are those who start out with great bursts of speed. We think surely they are going to win the race, but they soon drop out of the race. My prayer for all of us is that we don't drop out from the race. Some people get tired when they get to the middle of the race. Some people, when they are about to finish, they get tired. We need to continue and maintain the speed until we cross the finishing line. Matthew chapter 20, verse 16 talks about like a race, Christian life. Some who come to church join the church early, and some who join the church later. Jesus is saying that if we are not careful and we don't maintain the speed that we started with, it is possible that the first shall become last, and the last shall become first. Let's maintain the speed and continue to run. Are you even aware that you are running? You are in a race? Sometimes we forget ourselves that we are running, and we allow other things to distract us. For some, the pace is fast and are running very hard. Praise the Lord for such people who are running very hard. For others, the pace is slow. As if we are part of God's family, as if we are not part of God's family, as if we are running, as if we are not running. For others, we are weighed down by the distractions of this world or held back by sin in our lives. For others, they have forgotten that they are in a race and aren't running at all. But I want to remind all of you that we are in a race. Let's go back to the text that was read to us. Therefore, whenever a text begins with therefore, it means it's connecting with the previous text. Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, who are those cloud of witnesses? The therefore should take us to the chapter before this chapter 12, and that is the chapter 11. We will see the cloud of witnesses over there. Let us also lay aside every weight Because this cloud of witnesses, they laid aside every weight and sin which clings so closely and let us run with endurance. This cloud of witnesses, they ran with endurance. Let us also run with endurance. Who are these cloud of witnesses? Chapter 11 of Hebrews, of the book of Hebrews, talks about the heroes of faith. And we know them from Adam, we know them Abraham, we know them Isaac, we know them Jacob, we know them Moses, we know them, all these people. They are examples to us as people who have run the race and won. They run the race and they won. Not that they did not meet obstacles. They met obstacles, but they were able to run the race and they became winners. Therefore, by looking at these people, we should also continue to run until we win the race. Who are these people? These men and women who are in Hebrews chapter 11 did not accomplish great things because they were amazing people. They were like us. God took these normal people and did much through them because of their faith. So we read that by faith, Abraham did this. By faith, Jacob did this. By faith, Moses did this. It doesn't mean that these people were righteous people, were perfect. They did not give up. Even though they fell along the line, they did not give up. They ran until they won the race. Moses, as we know in scriptures, was once a murderer, but he ran the race and won. Abraham, at one point, lied, but he ran and won. Rahab was a prostitute, but we count her among the heroes of faith. David, at one point, was an adulterer. Sarah, a doubter, but they all ran and won the race. These people are not perfect people. It is a list of fallen sinners who put their trust in God and watch Him do amazing things in their lives. We need to run the race. What was their motivation? We read from Hebrews chapter 11, verse 10, by saying that for these people, they were looking for the city which has its foundations, and the builder and maker was God Himself. So they testify that Moses, he was looking for the city which has foundations, whose builder and maker is God. And that was their motivation. If your motivation for running this race is other people, then you have a problem. Your motivation should be the God who has called you to be part of His family. George Knight has a commentary on Hebrews chapter 12, 1 to 3. And this is his commentary. He says, "Now, instead of witnessing the exploits of these forebearers in faith, the readers of Hebrews, us, find themselves in a race of faith." So now in the stadium, we are not watching these people running anymore. We are watching ourselves in a race. In place of being spectators, they have become participants with the heroes of faith. We are running now a race. What can people say about us as we run? We can say so many things about Moses, but what can people say about us? We can say so many things about David, but what can people say about us? We can say so many things about Rahab. What can people say about us? We can see from the scripture that we have to run with endurance. What is endurance? But if the race is easy, then there's no need to run with endurance. Because sometimes the race is challenging. We need to run with endurance. What is endurance? Endurance, I saw and I read from a dictionary, and it tells me that the ability to keep doing something difficult, unpleasant, or painful for a long time. The ability to keep doing something difficult. Sometimes some of the tasks, some of the work that are assigned to us to do, sometimes some of them are difficult. But in order to maintain the speed in the race, we need to continue to do that. Sometimes some of the obstacles that come our way are unpleasant. Sometimes people do not even appreciate what you are doing. They don't appreciate it. But we should maintain the speed and continue to do it. Sometimes someone will say something that is so hurtful, painful. But in order for you to endure, you need to hold on to that pain and continue to run. I was trying to check from the Greek if that definition for endurance is different from what I read from the dictionary. And this is what I got from the original language, the Greek. Endurance means unyielding, deviant perseverance in the face of aggressive misfortune. Perseverance is very important. The heroes never gave up. We see the factors that brought them victory. We see the obstacles that they overcame in order for them to win. We see the glories of their triumphs. They endured. And that is what we have to do. Let me share with you about this guy. If you Google about this guy, you get so many things to say about him. His name is George Meagher. And this man set a record some years ago. What he did was that he walked on foot from South America, Argentina, to Alaska, United States of America, on foot. Not by plane, not by car or by ship, on foot. It took him 6.5 years to walk from Argentina to Alaska. And he shared with people that he wore 12 pairs of shoes. 12 pairs of shoes are the shoes that he used to walk from Argentina to Alaska. And guess how many miles that he walked? 19,019. Miles. 19,019 miles. I don't know how many of us here are able to walk 2 miles, 3 miles a day. Right? Gary will encourage us that walking is very good. We need to walk. He walked 19,000 plus miles. And the steps that he took in this walk was 41 million steps. 41 million steps. So when he came to Alaska and people got to know that this is what this man had done, they tried to interview him and wanted to know how he did it. And this is all that he was able to say. This is how I did it, one step after another. Friends, our Christian journey sometimes seems like a long walk. Jesus promised so many years that he was going to come soon. But how soon is the soon? It's taking 2,000 plus years. It seems a long distance. But I want to encourage you that it is not about the distance. It is not about the years. But it is all about making a step one after the other. Sometimes the race seems difficult, hard, meeting challenges every day. How do we do it? One step at a time, one day at a time. And let's continue to lean on Jesus. The good news about the test is that he says Jesus also had to go through that. And he overcame. And that's why he qualifies to sit at the right hand side of God. And he's interceding for us. And he is the finisher, the author and finisher of our faith. I was looking about this lady. Those of us who have been watching recent race. About 2 years ago, this lady was disqualified from running for the United States of America in a competition because they suspected that she has been using drugs. They disqualified her and she didn't take part in that race. But later, when they called her back, in fact, she was the one who ran faster in the U.S. But when they called her back to compete internationally, she came last. People were disappointed. She was at the ninth position. They were disappointed. But she did not give up. This year, I've been watching her, and she has been emerging the winner of almost all the competitions that she has done. She did not give up. To win the race, it is necessary to be disciplined, to be determined, and to endure. We don't have to wait for external forces to discourage us. Sometimes internal forces can also discourage us. But let's continue to run the race with endurance. Matthew chapter 10, verse 22 says, "And ye shall be hated of all men for my name's sake, but he that endureth to the end shall be saved." Some of the hindrances that we face, self-sufficiency. Some people think that they started earlier, and so automatically they should be winners. We have the starting point, and we have the finishing point. Friends, Jesus tells us that in John chapter 15, verse 5, "Apart from me, you can do nothing." It is only Jesus who can help us to become winners. Isaiah chapter 45, verse 22 says, "Look to me and be saved. I am God. And there is no other." Friends, we can't look at other people. Let's look at God. Another hindrance is pleasure of the world. The devil is so smart. Sometimes he plants interest in us so that we love things of the world. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 2 says, "We don't have to be lovers of pleasure. We rather have to be lovers of God." My prayer is that God will help all of us to be aware that we are in a race. And any mistake that we make, we cannot run to the end. Any distraction that comes our way might not help us to be at the finishing line. Let's continue to run and maintain the speed. For very soon, Redeemer, who is the author and finisher of our faith, will come in his glory. And when he comes, the good news is that we read from Revelation chapter 21, verse 7, he who overcomes will inherit these things. The winners of this race are going to inherit something that is not perishable. We are going to inherit the new earth and the new heaven. The holy city, the new Jerusalem. That is our goal. And God says, I will be their God, and they will be my Father. May the Lord continue to be with all of us. I just came to remind all of us that we are still in the race. Abraham, those people, they have come, they have gone. It is our time to be in the race. And we are running. We are all running. We have started. But we need to make sure that we get to the finishing line. The Lord be with us in Jesus' name. Amen. Shall we pray? Almighty Father, thank you so much for today, for reminding us that we are still in the race. Father, your desire is that we don't stop running, but that we continue to run in this race until we get to the finishing line. The devil is interested in our race. He doesn't want us to finish. He brings our way so many obstacles. Father, I pray, please help us to stand for you and let nothing distract us. I pray for my brothers and sisters who are here, and even those who couldn't make it here today, they are watching us from YouTube. My prayer is that continue to prepare all of us. Prepare us, O Lord, for the day that you shall come in your glory and to take us home to rest. We are no more happy in this world. Many bad things are happening around us. Fear, O Lord, grips us every day. We pray, help us so that we can continue to run and finish for the reward, for the prize that you have for us.